all the servants of the Lord, and I believe we are all the servants of God. And the one who stands by night in the house of the Lord, the one who guards, who prays, who waits for the Lord. And the Lord commands us to lift up our hands in the sanctuary and bless the name of the Lord. Why don't we all stand? Lord God, for your word. Thank you, O God, for allowing us to worship you in spirit and truth. Thank you, Father, for the presence of my brothers and sisters. Lord, bless our time as we seek you, as we worship you, O God. Father, may you cleanse us and may you forgive us from all our sins. Lord, forgive us. And by your grace, Lord God, we come to you. Thank you, Lord God, for your kindness and for your goodness, O Lord. We ask you, Lord God, to be with us as we sing praises in worship. As we listen to your word, O God, open our eyes, open our ears, O God. Lord, our hearts are ready to worship you, O God. We praise you and we magnify you, Lord God. May you also bless our preacher for today, Pastor Jesus. Lord, give him wisdom and understanding. Thank you, Father. We commit to you the purpose of today. In Jesus' name. Amen. Let's continue worshiping God. Great is your faithfulness.
Thank you. Magnificent, eternal. Church, how are you doing today? Good. Can you please turn to the person next to you and say good afternoon na pala. Good afternoon. I'm just glad that you're here. For those of you who are joining us via Zoom, hindi ko alam saan ba camera natin ito pala. We're having some technical difficulties, but just the same, we just want to thank the Lord for this opportunity. He is indeed a magnificent God. Amen. And why don't we just take this time to just pray together? I want you to not grab a partner, but face someone, okay? And then directly ask for his or her prayer request. Wala nang kumustahan, walang chikahan. Just go directly ask, how can I pray for you today? Can we do that? And for those of you who are via Zoom, di ko alam, we have not coordinated this yet. We're just doing this right now. But I want you to also be in prayer. Pray for our country. Pray for those who are sick. Pray for your family members. And then just spend the next 2-3 minutes praying for one another. Can you just do that? Go ahead. Just pray. Pray for one another.
Lord, we thank you so much for this wonderful time that we can have together to pray, worship you, Father, and sing songs. Indeed, you are magnificent, God. You are great and mighty God. You are Jesus. We lift up your name on high, Father. We just want to claim your promises, O God. We
despite all our circumstances, O God, despite all the things that are happening around us, Lord, we give you praise, we give you honor, O God. Lord, things may be hard, things may be challenging. We see of news of loved ones, friends who are getting sick, some even dying. Many people losing their jobs, losing their business, Lord, but it doesn't change the fact that you still are a good God and that you are still in control of every situation in our lives. And Lord, allow us, Lord, to just have this time to ponder upon your goodness, the richness of your words, and your presence, Father, speaking to us, even through the songs, even through our prayer time. Father, be with us right now, wherever we are, regardless of our situations, Lord. Father, we just want to declare this. You are a magnificent God. You are a wonderful God. You are a glorious Lord. Church, just say that to the Lord right now. Lord, you are magnificent. We love you, Lord. We give you praise, Father God. And we simply want to honor you, Father. And we just sing that chorus part again. You are magnificent.
You are magnificent.
Just make this your prayer right now. Say to the Lord. Yes, Father, you are a wonderful God.
Glorious Jesus. No one ever
will. And last time, you were.
You are my
yes, Jesus. Make that your prayer right now. Say that to the Lord. Yes, God. Own it. Own it, church. You are wonderful.
Glorious Jesus. No one ever will compare to you, Jesus.
No one ever will compare to you, Lord. And with that, we give you praise. We give you the highest glory, the highest honor, the highest praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Can we give Lord God's praise? Come on. Yun palakpak po niya. Para sa akin lang yan. Let's give the Lord God's praise. Amen. Amen. Right now, we have a special guest speaker. Not a guest speaker, because he's not here with us. But yesterday, we had the chance to record this video message. Because as per restrictions, bawal daw ang mga seniors dito. But we're glad that Pastor James can be with us via this video message. And so, without much ado, we will now be playing the video. And if our tech team is ready.
On the beauty of God's plan, and that it is perfectly designed. Taken from the letter written by the Apostle Paul to the Roman believers on chapter 8, verse 28, a very familiar and most quoted passage in the New Testament. Let me read it to you. And we know that God causes all things to work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to His purpose. For Christians, this verse contains perhaps the most glorious promise in Scripture. It is breathtaking in its scale, all-embracing absolutely all that pertains to a believer's life. This marvelous promise consists of four elements that continues Paul's teaching about the believer's eternal salvation or security in God's eternal plan of salvation. First, it's certainty. Second, it's extent. Thirdly, it's recipients and its source. Let's start unboxing this verse. The message title for today is Unboxing God's Eternal Plan of Salvation of Believers. Unbox 1. The certainty of God's eternal plan of salvation of believers. The praise and we know. In the context of the truths that follow in the book of Romans chapter 8, these three simple words express the Christian's absolute certainty of eternal salvation or security in the Holy Spirit. Paul is not expressing his personal intuitions or opinions, but is setting forth the inerrant truth of God's word. It is not Paul the man, but Paul the apostle and channel of God's revelation who continues to declare the truth he has received from the Holy Spirit. He therefore asserts with God's own authority that as believers in Jesus Christ, we know beyond all doubt that every aspect of our lives is in God's hands and will be divinely used by the Lord, not only to manifest His own glory, but also to work out our own ultimate blessing. The phrase we know here carries the meaning of can know. Tragically, many Christians throughout the history of the church, including many in our own day, refuse to believe that God guarantees the believer's eternal salvation or security. Such denial is tied to the belief that salvation is a cooperative effort between man and God. And although God will not fail on his side, man might. Thus, the sense of insecurity. Belief in salvation by a sovereign God alone, however, leads to the confidence that salvation is secure, because God, who alone is responsible, cannot fail. Beyond that theological consideration, Paul is saying that the truth of eternal salvation is clearly revealed by God to us, so that all believers are able with certainty to know the comfort and hope of that reality if they simply take God at His word. God's child need never fear being cast out of his heavenly Father's house or fear losing his citizenship in his eternal kingdom of righteousness. Unbox 2. The extent of God's eternal plan of salvation of believers, that God causes all things to work together for good. The extent of the believer's security is as limitless as its certainty is absolute. As with every other element of the believer's security, God is the guarantor. It is He who causes everything in the believer's life, my life, your life, our lives, to result in blessing. Paul emphasizes that God Himself brings about the good that comes to His people. This marvelous promise does not operate through detached statements, but requires divine action to fulfill. God's decree of security is actually carried out by the direct, personal, and gracious work of His divine Son and His Holy Spirit. Hence, also, Christ is able to save forever those who draw near to God through Him, since He always lives to make intercession for them. And as Paul has just proclaimed, the Spirit Himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. And He who searches the hearts knows what the mind of the Spirit is, because He intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. The phrase all things is utterly comprehensive, having no qualifications or limits. Neither this verse nor its text context allows for restrictions or conditions. All things is inclusive in the fullest possible sense. Nothing existing or occurring in heaven or on earth shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus. Paul is not saying that God prevents His children from experiencing things that can harm them. He is rather demonstrating that the Lord takes all that He allows to happen to His beloved children, even the worst things, and turns those things ultimately into blessings. No matter what our situation, our suffering, our persecution, our sinful failure, our pain, our lack of faith, in those things, as well as in all other things, our Heavenly Father will work to produce our ultimate victory and blessing. The outcome of that truth is that nothing can ultimately work against us. If God is for us, who can be against us? Any temporary harm we suffer will be used by God for our own benefit. All things include circumstances and events that are good and beneficial in themselves, as well as those that are in themselves evil and harmful. To work together translates synergeo, from which is derived the English term synergism. The working together of various elements to produce an effect greater than and often completely different from the sum of its elements acting separately. In the physical world, the right combination of otherwise harmful chemicals can produce substances that are extremely beneficial. For example, ordinary table salt is composed of two poisons, sodium and chlorine. As what in the King James rendering seems to suggest, it is not that things in themselves work together to produce good. As Paul has made clear earlier in the verse, it is God's providential power and will, not a natural synergism of circumstances and events in our lives, that causes them to work together for good. David testified to the marvelous truth when he exulted, "All the paths of the Lord are loving kindness and truth to those who keep His covenants and His testimonies." No matter what road we are on or path we take, the Lord will take it into a way of loving kindness and truth. Paul likely has in mind our good during this present life as well as ultimately in the life to come. No matter what happens in our lives, as God's children, the providence of God, our Savior, uses it for our temporal as well as our eternal benefit. Sometimes by saving us from tragedies, and sometimes by sending us to them in order to draw us closer to Him. Therefore, we do not lose heart, Paul counseled the Corinthian believers. But though our outer man is decaying, yet our inner man is being renewed day by day. For momentary light affliction is producing for us an eternal weight of glory far beyond all comparison. Even when our outward circumstances are dire, perhaps especially when they are dire and seemingly hopeless from our perspective, God is purifying and renewing our redeemed inner beings in preparation for glorification to ultimate good. And Acts 3, the recipients of God's eternal plan of salvation loves God. To those who love God. First, Paul describes the recipients of eternal salvation as those who love God. Nothing more characterizes the true believer than genuine love for God. Redeemed people love the gracious God who has saved them. The New Testament is equally clear that those who belong to God love Him. Just as it is written, Paul reminded the Corinthians, "Things which eye has not seen, and ear has not heard, and which have not entered the heart of man, all that God has prepared for those who love Him." Later in that letter, he declared, "If anyone love God, he is known by Him." James says that those who love God, that is, believers, are promised the Lord's eternal crown of life. Paul refers to Christians as those who love our Lord Jesus Christ with the love incorruptible. Saving faith involves much more than simply acknowledging God. Do you know that even the demons fearfully believe that God is one and is all-powerful? James 1:2:19. True faith involves the surrendering of one's sinful self to God for self-forgiveness and receiving Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. And the first mark of saving faith is love for God. True salvation produces lovers of God because the love of God has been poured out within our hearts through the Holy Spirit who was given to us. It is not by accident that Paul lists love as the first fruit of the Spirit. Love for God is closely related to forgiveness because the redeemed believer cannot help being grateful for God's gracious forgiveness. When the sinful woman, doubtlessly a prostitute, washed and anointed Jesus' feet in the Pharisee's house, the Lord explained to his resentful host that she expressed great love. Why? Because she had been forgiven great sins. Love for God is also related to obedience. The Lord says, "Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not do what I say?" The persistently disobedient heart is an unbelieving and unloving heart because the love of Christ controls us. His world will also control us. "You are my friends," Jesus said, if you do what I commanded you." In context, it is clear that Jesus uses the term friend as synonym for a true disciple. Obviously, we do not love Christ as fully as we ought because we are still imperfect and are contaminated by the sinful remnants of the old self. It is for that reason that Paul told the Philippians, "And this I pray, that your love may abound still more and more in real knowledge and all discernment." Their love for Christ was genuine, but it was not yet perfect. Genuine love for God has many facets and manifestations. First, godly love longs for personal communion with the Lord. It was that desire which led the psalmist to proclaim, "As the deer pants for the water brooks, so my soul pants for thee, O God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When shall I come and appear before God? And whom am I in heaven but thee? And besides thee, I desire nothing on earth." Second, genuine love for God trusts in his power to protect his own. David admonished fellow believers, "Oh, love the Lord, all you his godly ones. The Lord preserves the faithful." Third, genuine love for God is characterized by peace that only he can impart. Those who love the law have great peace, and nothing causes them to stumble. As believers, we have a divine and secure peace that the world cannot give, possess, understand, or take away. Fourth, genuine love for God is sensitive to his will and his honor. When God is blasphemed, repudiated, or in any way dishonored, his faithful children suffer pain on his behalf. David so identified himself with the Lord that he could say, "Zeal for thy house has consumed me, and the reproaches of those who reproach thee have fallen on me." Fifth, genuine love for God loves the things that God loves. And we know what he loves through the revelation of his word. Throughout Psalms 119, the writer expresses love for God's law, God's ways, God's standards, and all else that is God's. "The law of thy mouth is better to me than thousands of gold and silver pieces. Oh, I love thy law. It is my meditation all the day. How sweet are thy words to my taste, yes, sweeter than honey to my mouth." David testified, "I will bow down toward thy holy temple and give thanks to thy name for thy loving kindness and thy truth. For thou hast magnified thy word according to all thy name." Sixth, genuine love for God loves the people God loves. John repeatedly and unequivocally asserts that a person who does not love God's children does not love God and does not belong to God. "We know that we have passed out of death into life," the apostle says, "because we love the brethren. He who does not love abides in death. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God, and everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. The one who does not love does not know God, for God is love." in the strongest possible language, John declares that if someone says, "I love God," and hates his brother, he is a liar. For the one who does not love his brother whom he has seen cannot love God whom he has not seen. And this commandment we have from him, that the one who loves God should love his brother also. In the next chapter, he declares just as firmly that whoever loves the Father loves the child born of him. By this, we know that we love the children of God when we love God and observe his commandments. 7. Genuine love for God hates what God hates. Godly love cannot tolerate evil. The loving Christian grieves over sin, first of all for sin in his own life, but also for sin in the lives of others, especially in the lives of fellow believers. When the cock's crow reminded Peter of his Lord's prediction, he wept bitterly over his denial of Christ, which he had just made for the third time. On the other hand, to love the world and the things of the world is to love what God hates. And John therefore solemnly warns, if anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. 8. Genuine love for God longs for Christ's return. Paul rejoiced in the knowledge that in the future there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. And not only to me, but also to all who have loved his appearing. 9. And finally, the overarching mark of genuine love for God is obedience. He who has my commandments and keeps them, Jesus said, he it is who loves me. And he who loves me shall be loved by my Father, and I will love him, and I will disclose myself to him. As noted above in the citation of 1 John chapter 5, verses 1 to 2, obedience to God is inextricably tied both to love for God and love for fellow believers. Although we are commanded to love God and fellow believers, that love does not and cannot originate with us. Godly love is given. Love is from God, John explains. And therefore, it is not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be a propitiation for our sins. We are able to love only because God has first loved us. Unbox 3b, the recipients of God's eternal salvation are called, to those who are called. Paul describes the recipients of eternal salvation as those who are called. Just as our love originates with God, so does our calling into his heavenly family. In every way, the initiative and provision for salvation are God's. When Jesus said that many are called, but few are chosen, he was referring to the gospel's external call to all men to believe in him. In the history of the church, nothing is more obvious than the fact that many, perhaps most people who receive this call, do not accept it. But in the epistles, the terms called and calling are used in a different sense, referring to the sovereign regenerating work of God in a believer's heart that brings him to new life in Christ. Paul explains the meaning of those who are called in the following two verses, where he speaks of what theologians often refer to as God's effectual call. In this sense, all those who are called are chosen and redeemed by God and are ultimately glorified. They are securely predestined by God to be his children and to be conformed to the image of his Son. Although human faith is imperative for salvation, God's gracious initiation of salvation is even more imperative. Jesus declared categorically, "No one can come to me unless it has been granted him from the Father." God's choice not only precedes man's choice, but makes man's choice possible and effective. As Paul explains a few verses later, God also uses human agents in making effective his call to salvation. How then shall they call upon him in whom they had not believed? And how shall they believe in him whom they had not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? It is through the content of his word, specifically the truth of the gospel message, and through the power of his Holy Spirit, that God brings men to himself. Peter succinctly states that the first of those two principles, you have been born again, not of seed which is perishable, but imperishable, that is through the living and abiding word of God. Paul states the second principle in these words, for by one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, whether slaves or free, and we were all made to drink of one Spirit. Lastly, on Acts 4, the source of God's eternal plan of salvation of believers according to his purpose. At the end of verse 28, Paul states the source of the believer's security in Christ. God causes all things to work together for the good of his children because that is according to his divine purpose, plan, or agenda. Paul expands on and clarifies the meaning of God's purpose in verses 29 to 30. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to become conformed to the image of his Son, so that he will be the firstborn among many brethren. And these whom he predestined, he also called. And these whom he called, he also justified. And these whom he justified, he also glorified. Deeply explained, God's broader purpose is to offer salvation to all mankind. As our Lord declared at the beginning of his earthly ministry, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, so that whoever believes in him did not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send the Son into the world to judge the world, but that the world should be saved through him. In his second letter, Peter states that the Lord does not desire the condemnation of any person, but wants all to come to repentance. In Romans chapter 8, verse 28, however, Paul is speaking on a narrower, restricted meaning of God's purpose, namely his divine plan to save those whom he has called and predestined to become conformed to the image of his Son. The focus is on God's sovereign plan of redemption, which he ordained upon the foundation of the earth. Isaiah wrote, "For I am God, and there is no other. I am God, and there is no other like me, declaring the end from the beginning, and from ancient times things which have not been done, saying, my purpose will be established, and I will accomplish all my good pleasure. Calling a bird of prey from the east, the man of my purpose from a far country. Truly I have spoken, truly I will bring it to pass. I have planned it, surely I will do it." John wrote of Jesus, "But as many as receive him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, even to those who believe in his name, who were not born of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God." In conclusion, what is the point of unboxing God's eternal plan of salvation for believers? So that we can find rest, comfort, hope, and peace to our weary souls, by knowing and trusting the promises of God our Savior in his word, for he is faithful. This will enable us to sustain our spiritual lives and provide stability when crises, problems, issues, and difficulties and pressures comes our way. If you look at it like what we are experiencing right now, this pandemic, this is nothing compared to God's plan in the lives of each and one of us. And if you are bothered, the Lord Jesus Christ said, "Come to me, who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." That's why we are encouraged by the Apostle Paul as he wrote in the book of Colossians, chapter 3, verse 16, let the word of Christ richly dwell within you, with all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another with psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with thankfulness in your hearts to God. One of my favorite passages in Scripture is from 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 to 5. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to His great mercy has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to obtain an inheritance which is imperishable and undefiled and will not fade away, reserved in heaven for you, who are protected by the power of God through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. Thank you and God bless you all.
Thank you, Pastor James, for the message. Thank you for delivering.
About the things that God has prepared for each one of us. So right now, at this moment, we will worship God through our offerings, tithes and offerings. So maybe all bow down, close our eyes, and let's pray. Father God, thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to hear your words. And Lord, may your word richly planted in our hearts brings joy, Lord God, and brings worship to you. Thank you, Lord God, at this time, po, Panginoon, want to commit our tithes and offerings to you. Salamat po, Panginoon, sa kakayahan for the ability to produce, Lord God. May you bless the hands of my brothers and sisters. And those who cannot give today, Lord God, may you bless them and may you provide for all their needs. We commit to you, Lord, yung tithes and offerings for the partners of your kingdom here. In Jesus' name, amen. You may also drop all your tithes and offerings at the back. There's a small box there. So we will let the basket. Okay. Just put your tithes and offerings there. So can we call the pastor, Derek, for closing prayer?
Mr. Lord, shall we all rise? I know that the Lord has blessed us today. Amen. So join me as we conclude our worship service. And let's thank God and let's close our service in prayer. Once again, Father in heaven, we thank you for this wonderful day of worship. Thank you, Lord, for allowing us to congregate, to praise you, to glorify you, to live your name on high. Truly, God, that you're amazing, and you continually fixing our lives, Panginoon. And even today, Panginoon, we experience the power of your Holy Spirit that empower each and everyone, not only here in for the Trinity, but also to those brethren and us. Thank you, Lord, for everything that transpired today. And even we have been reminded by the message of Pastor James that truly, God, you are so great sa aming buhay. Your love even is in control in our lives. And as we close this worship service, Panginoon, we continually asking for your provision, protection, Panginoon, sa aming pagiran, Panginoon, that still suffering and experiencing any difficulties in lives, though they are physically broken. But we know that you are completely fixing them, Panginoon, binubuo mo, Panginoon, ang kanilang buhay, spiritually, Panginoon. And that is the hope that we are always considered and pinangahawakan namin, Panginoon, sa aming buhay. And even, Lord, as we also pray, Panginoon, sa aming upcoming worship service next Friday, that all those chairs, because of the Trinity, you will fill it, Panginoon, with the souls, so that we can join together, not only in Zoom, but physically, Panginoon. Because you have allowed us now and then to continue, Panginoon, to be in this place, in your sanctuary, Panginoon. Maraming pong salamat, Lord. And we thank you for all our brethren that you have used dito, Panginoon, sa aming worship service, especially the multiplication dimension that you will use them mightily, Panginoon, to improve everything na nandito sa loob ng aming church, Panginoon. Maraming pong salamat, Lord. And now to Him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to His power that is at work with us. To Him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus all generation, forever and ever. Amen and amen. Makakapo naman tayo po sa announcement.
Praise the Lord for the 94 attendees today. Those who are in the XCC, Polyclinity here, and also in the Zoom. Praise God for the 94 attendees. So, thank you for kasama namin kayong nag-worship sa ating Panginoon. And for the announcement, kindly visit our Chronicles. O yan. All right. Okay, adult school, every Saturday starting. Building leaders. Okay. And for the yun na, yung ating incoming adult school, magsisimula sa September 18, 8 to 10. Alright. So, for those birthdays and anniversaries, just visit our Chronicles and greet those brethren. Magsa-celebrate ng ating birthdays. Alright. Happy birthday, Sister Lloyda Anastasio. Right to Pastor Jan. September 11, Brother Alvin Montesillo. Happy birthday, bro. Kahit nasa Pilipinas ka. And Sister Gemmaline, wife of Pastor June Sena. So September 12. That's it. So, praise the Lord. Kung wala ng announcement. And, nga pala, may nakalimutan ako. Yung ating guest, si Miss Regine Tolentino.
Artista
yun eh. Regine Tolentino. Welcome again po, sis. At next Friday, see you po. And kung wala na pong ibang announcement, okay, yun lang po. This is your worship leader, Pastor Bon. See you next Friday. God bless you all.
Thank you so much. Pwede po tayo magbatian. Of course, Miss Pops lang po. Wala pong beso-beso. Dahil kami nice na camera. Okay, and those who are via Zoom, salamat po for joining us today. And we apologize for the technicalities, but we're working on it. And Lord willing, ating mga kaharap na yung mas magandang solution in the future. God bless you po. Mag-invite po tayo next week para dumami po tayo dito.
Ibang
yun na kasama. God bless you. God bless.
God bless po.
Amen. God bless po.
Hello, Zoom viewers. Magandang umaga, magandang tanghali, magandang hapon po sa inyo. Pwede na po ninyong
God bless everyone.
Microphone.
God bless everyone.
Yes. God bless.
Hello.
God bless.
Hello.